You're listening to the Common Fan Podcast, a Husker football podcast for the common fan by the common fan.
Welcome back to the Common Fan Podcast. I am TJ Burkle, as always, alongside Matty Owens Sr. and Geoff in Lincoln. Hey, Common Fans, you can now get 25% off beef purchased at cpbeef.com using the promo code COMMONFAN, all one word, Common Fan. Certified Piedmontese is premium Nebraska beef, raised and grazed by Nebraska ranchers in the beautiful Sand Hills region of the state. They've got all the beef your heart desires. The absolute best steaks for your Sunday family dinner, ribs for your fantasy football draft, burgers and dogs for your tailgate, and much more. Stop by your local Mercado Butcher Shop in Lincoln or Omaha, or get 25% off at cpbeef.com using promo code COMMONFAN. And get certified Piedmontese products shipped right to your front door anywhere across all 50 states. Certified Piedmontese, powering the Husker football team and powering the Common Fan Podcast. Also, make sure to check out our brand new website, www.commonfan.co. Sign up for our free newsletter, subscribe on YouTube, and keep up with all the fun and frivolity of the Common Fans. We went to TS Web Services to build the site for us. Their team of experts is dedicated to providing top-notch solutions tailored to your needs. Whether you need web development or hosting, they've got you covered. You can trust TS Web Services to take your online presence to the next level. We had a great experience working with their team. They were very responsive and delivered high-quality work. TS Web Services can help improve, redesign, or host your website. And you can see a great example of their work at www.commonfan.co. Excuse me. Our guest today is the co-host of Unsportsmanlike Conduct on 1620 The Zone. He is the host of Chasing 3 Hours podcast. I'd like to hear how that is different from Chasing 3, the Husker football YouTube series. And also the creator, along with Jack Mitchell, of the I-80 Club, an online community of Husker fans featuring regular episodes, shows, and Husker-focused content and engagement. Josh Peterson, thank you so much for joining the Common Fans today. How are you, sir?
Boys, thanks for having me. I'm doing fantastic as the start of the season is ever so close.
Tell us about what you're up to. Like, you have like 17 podcasts and radio shows. How do you keep up with it all? I'd love to know what happens if you lose your voice.
Great question. Knock on wood, I haven't had that happen just yet, but I know that it'll definitely go down at some point in time. So yeah, I do the radio show. We're on every day from 2 to 6 on 1620 The Zone. John Bishop and myself, we've been on the air for 10 years. This will be actually our 11th football season, which is just wild. I've been working at The Zone since 2012. You mentioned the I-80 Club. Jack and I have been doing that since 2022. We started that, I think, in July of 2022. And so we are rolling into our third season, our first one where it'll be on YouTube. And so we're really excited. We got some super fun stuff going on, this season. We're on Wednesdays and then Saturday mornings, and we'll be doing a post game show on Saturday nights this fall. And then, yeah, Chasing 3 Hours is my, my running focused podcast where I interview people, whether it's locally or around the country, about their running journeys and all sorts of stuff. Chasing 3 Hours started last summer. My newsletter started in February of 2022. So I might sue Matt Rhule because he stole it, and I haven't picked up any new listeners. All my listeners are runners. I haven't picked up any random Husker fans on accident to stumble upon my stuff.
You were Chasing 3 Hours before he was Chasing 3.
Bingo. Also, I mean, if we're going to be technical, shouldn't they be Chasing 4? Like, you don't want to just tie. Nebraska hasn't scored in overtime in many, many years. It's been since 2014. So I think they should have been Chasing 4, which then we could have all come together.
Could have avoided this whole thing.
Yeah.
Bingo. Everything would have been fine.
What is Chasing 3 Hours? Like, is that a reference to
the marathon?
Like, I'm not a runner at all. Is that a marathon? Is that a half marathon?
Yep. Matt nailed it. So it's a 3-hour marathon, which, you know, I know a lot of people, and I know I viewed it this way too. It's like this, if you can reach that, it's like it takes you from like, oh, cool, to like you're a serious runner. It's also a nice round number, right? Like 3 hours is fun. Yeah. So I started my newsletter a couple of years ago thinking like, this will be sweet. I'll document my years long chase. And then I did it 7 months later, which was awesome. But it now I have this name that I thought, you know, I wouldn't break it for many more years. So I did it for the first time in Chicago back in 2022.
So you ran a full marathon in under 3 hours.
Yeah, I've done it three times now.
Yeah. That's so lightning fast.
That's impressive. I am neither a runner nor a golfer. But what is that like? The equivalent would be like what? Breaking 100, breaking 90, breaking 80. Like what would kind of the equivalent be? 85.
Good question, man. I don't know. Like I've never thought about it. Yeah, like I feel like it's pretty good in golf terms. Like, yeah, someone who maybe regularly shoots in the 70s. You know, I'm very. I guess I don't know for sure. I'm very serious. I run. Right now, I'm running over 70 miles a week, and soon it'll be above 80
Good
miles
God,
a week.
Man.
So, yeah, I put a lot wow. of – I run about 10 to 12 hours a week, you know.
I ran a 7-minute mile when I was a freshman in high school, and it was like the crowning achievement of my life.
Hell yeah, dude. That's awesome.
Did you throw up afterwards?
Yeah, a little bit.
don't sell yourself short, Geoff. People forget this if they ever knew it, but Geoff was the gunner on – or not the gunner, but he was the he was the on our freshman football team. He called the cadence and called for the snap and was the whatever the guy is in the, you know, behind in between the long snapper and the punter.
Oh right? Yeah, up back.
That was the up back. Yeah, that was.
I led the charge down the field. That was 95 pounds. It was awesome.
Yeah,
there we go.
No, that was an inspiration for all of us, Geoff. Yeah. Those of us who were freshmen at Pius X Central Catholic High School in 1997. So thank you, Geoff, for your leadership. All right. Okay, Josh, we want to kind of dive in on a specific topic with you today. There's a lot of hype around this 2024 Nebraska football team. There's national media buzz. There's local media buzz. You can tell Coach Rhule is confident. At the very least, I would say everybody expects the Huskers to be better this year. I mean, I think like it's safe to say 98% or maybe 90, let's be conservative, 92% of Husker fans or more believe we're at least getting to a bowl game, and some think we could get to 8 or 9 wins or even more. And you know what this reminds me of? It reminds me an awful lot of 2019. All right. So let's think about some similarities. You've got a second year head coach that people are high on. Both had a kind of a rough transition year in year one, but people are willing to give a lot of grace for the transition year. They've got a record of success at other schools and kind of considered to be a great fit at their current school. That was true of Scott Frost in 2019. It's true of Matt Rhule now. In both seasons, there is a young quarterback involved that's getting tons of hype. Of course, in 2019, at least Adrian Martinez had played a year. Dylan Raiola, in this case, not officially been named the starter, but is viewed by many people to be your QB1. Pretty much. At least a universal belief that the QB is a net positive for the team. Right. And like will be, I guess in 2AM's case, people thought he would take a leap from year one. In Dylan's case, we think he will at least be better than what we had in year one for Matt Rhule. I think it's also safe to say the schedule is considered to be favorable. And it was in 2019 as well. At least the first part of the schedule, we had to play Ohio State in 2019, but the other two crossovers way back in the time of divisions were Indiana and Maryland. Also just sort of interesting, neither here nor there, just like in 2024, just like in 2019, in 2024, Nebraska will play Colorado in game two and Illinois in game four. And in 2019, we blew a 17 point lead. A 17-point halftime lead at Colorado in game two. And then we beat Illinois at Illinois in game four. It was like 42-38. We had
that was a wild game. Yeah, that was a crazy game.
It was
14-0 like that.
Yeah, it was really ugly. It was like, yep. We're not going to lose this game, are we?
Yep,
and we almost lost it.
Yeah.
And so anyway, like both of those games are at home this year instead of away, but kind of an eerie similarity. And then, of course, the 2019 Huskers were actually in the AP top 25 going into the season. the Frost hype train was off the rails, but we are getting votes. And Joel Klatt, for instance, just put us in his top 25. Like there is, I don't think, you know, we're not in the AP or the coaches top 25 or will be probably before the season, but similar sort of levels of hype. And I found myself thinking the other day, Josh, how glad I was that this time it won't be like 2019. Like this time it'll be different.
It's different.
And totally 2019 different. Was such a huge disappointment. We ended up 5-7 in 2019. We didn't go to a bowl game. We blew leads against Colorado and Indiana and Purdue and Iowa. Like we literally should have won at least two of those games, could have won all four of them. But then I was like, okay, self, are you sure? Are we sure that it will be better or different this time? And I think we as a fan base have so much PTSD, it's hard not to go to the bad negative place and think twice about our optimism. And so I want to get all into this episode and talk about why. I should say, as we start, I do believe 2024 will be better and different. And I want to get into why that may be. But first off, Josh, like, are there as many similarities to 2019 as we think? Like, is this a fair comparison or is this overblown a bit?
No, I mean, you're definitely onto something. I think year twos for every coach, really going back to, you know, I can't speak for Osborne, but so going back to Solich, you know, certainly his best season was year two, right? They go 12-1. They win the conference. You guys covered that year in the Solich episode you did. You know, year two was the first Callahan year that they had a winning record. Year two under Bo, the best defense of my lifetime, certainly. You know, and if they have a semblance of an offense, who knows what happens. I do think that year three was his best team, but year two was very good. Year two of Mike Riley, the last winning season that Nebraska has had. And oddly, year two under Scott Frost, his best season too, which is very wild because they went 5-7. So I think year two for all of those coaches, I can certainly speak to the Callahan, Bo, Riley, Frost mindset that I had going into them. And I was expecting a jump, right? Like I was expecting things to get better. In the case of 2019, man, when you get reminded that they were a top 25 team in the preseason, it's like kind of wild to think back to. And so I would say this, just kick off the conversation. I do think that the hype was a lot higher 5 years ago than it is right now. I think for a variety of reasons, I think you hit on one of them, the quarterback. Like we knew what Nebraska had with, or at least we thought we did with Adrian Martinez, right? Like right now it's still very much of an unknown. I think that we hadn't been beaten down even more as a collective, whether it's media or fans. And so I definitely sense a bit of tepidness. Though, you know, John and I have done our poll question. We do these four phases of polling where we like, hey, what's Nebraska's record going to be? The optimism right now is actually higher than at any point in the last 4 years. We didn't do a poll like this in 2019, though I know that those numbers would have been ridiculous. So I think that there is excitement, but I do feel like people are guarding themselves. Kind of like TJ's, you're like, am I being correct in thinking this? Does seem like that people are at least asking themselves the question before they say, nah, they'll be 8-4 or 9-3. Everything's going to be just fine.
Real quick, I know Matty O's got a question, but what is the leader in the clubhouse right now in terms of your poll? What are people saying?
So we, like I said, we started doing this in 2021. And so by that point, you know, Nebraska had not made a bowl game in what, 17, 18, 19, and 20. And so we made our four options, and some people were very critical of them at the time, and we've kept with them ever since. So we had four options. The first one is 3-9 or worse. The second one is 4-8 or 5-7. The next one is 6-6 or 7-5. And then the last one is 8-4 or better. And so we really like those because it forces you to say they're going to go sub 500 and like, are they going to be really bad or just like kind of bad? And then like slightly above 500 or 500 or then 8-4 better. So 57% of our votes right now are at the 6-6 or 7-5. 36.8% of the votes are 8-4 or better. So if you combine those, you're looking at 94%. We call it the positivity index. That is easily the highest positivity index, and it's breaking the previous positivity index, which was from the spring when it was like 70-something% or not. I don't remember. Maybe it was already in the 90s. Either way, this season is the most optimistic that Husker fans have been since the pretty much the tail end of the Scott Frost era.
Wow.
Let's break that positivity index like the copier in Office Space.
There yes. you go.
Well, I think one reason for more optimism than before, I think, and I'm sure many Husker fans agree, is how quickly Tony White flipped that defense last year, right? Mm-hmm. Like I don't really recall how good the defense was going from 2018 to 2019, but I know they weren't this good. So I think it's safe to say this defense will be better than 2019, but Josh, from what you've seen and heard, do you think this year's defense can take a leap even from where how good they were last year and be even better this year?
I think it's the question, man, that I've been asking myself throughout the last, whatever, 8 months. I really have, because I think the offense is going to be improved. And certainly, you know, we'll talk about them tonight. I think that they're going to be improved. I think that they have a better quarterback, but it's like, if to go from like the 5 wins to like 6 or 7, I think is just about like not shooting yourself in the foot and not turning the ball over 100 yes. times. To go from like 6-6 to 8-4, 9-3, then that takes more, really increasing the level of play everywhere. And I think defense is one of those spots. Like they were very good, obviously. As we all know, one of the things that I have focused on a lot this offseason, and we, John and I actually talked about them, recently, and that was like sacks, takeaways. But the other thing that's kind of been my pet project, and I actually want to do a little bit more before the season, is third down defense. Nebraska last year was in the top 50, in third down defense, pretty solid, you know, given that they were put on the field in disadvantageous situations a whole lot. But what was pretty wild to me was looking at those numbers in wins and losses. In wins last year, Nebraska's third down conversion rate on defense was 26%. In losses, it was all the way up to 44%. 26% for the whole season would have been a top three unit. When you look at it from the negative perspective, you're talking about a like close to the bottom, 120 something. And so like, that's pretty interesting that as good as the defense was and as good collectively as the third down defense was, when they lost games, that was a huge reason why. I mean, it started in the opener, right? Like I know one of the plays that Minnesota had at the end of the game, the Jordan catch, if you will, was a fourth down play, but they got third down conversions. And it happened in essentially all of those games. Colorado got some momentum going with third downs. And certainly, you know, when they lost four straight, you know, at the end of the year, it was third down. So like, can they improve on that? And I mean, dude, splash plays, sacks and takeaways, you know, the goals, Matt Rhule talked about one of them this week was 20 takeaways. Who was it? Jamari Butler. He mentioned 40 sacks. Like those are last time that happened around here was 2009. So, you know, it's obviously a pretty lofty goal. I don't know if they can reach those numbers, but it's like, can you raise the floor? Cause they had 3 games last year with 0 sacks. Can you raise that floor where the low number in games is maybe 1 sack and maybe 1 game, but then otherwise it's always 2 or more. Yeah. Like that's how you start changing things and going again from 6-6 to 8-4, 9-3.
Yeah. Well, hopefully like this probably is a lofty goal, but hopefully it's one of those like shoot for the moon and you'll land amongst the stars kind of things. Because even if they get to 30 sacks and I don't know, mm-hmm. 16, 17 takeaways, like it's still pretty damn good. So
yeah. Yeah. Last year they had 32 sacks and I looked it up today. 16 of those were in 2 games. So, wow. You know, that was Colorado and that's because Shador Sanders holds onto the ball. And then the Northwestern game. And so they went 1-1 in those games. So think about that. 16 sacks in 2 games. In the other 10, they only had 16. So 1.6 per game. And like I said, 3 games, they had 0 sacks. So it's like, all right, how do you spread that? How do you, instead of having 8 in 2 games, how do you have maybe 6 in like 3? And then, you know, 5 in a couple, 4 in a few. And then like, again, the floor being 2 or 3 a game. Now you're really, really cooking. And certainly getting takeaways would just be monumental, just because we saw what happened last year. Nebraska turns the ball over, gives the other team closer, you know, field advantage or whatever it is. Like, oh man, it's a game changer if you give your offense a short field, especially with a true freshman quarterback.
Absolutely.
Sure. Let's pivot for a second here from defense. Like, let's talk about the program as a whole, because I think another similarity with it being a second year head coach is just the foundation and what's kind of going on and off the field. With the Frost tenure early on, it's pretty crazy to think that we all thought there were massive improvements in the culture and the foundation of the program. And now with hindsight and in retrospect, some of the things that kind of came to light after the fact, maybe after Frost left, that may not have been necessarily the case. But in year two of Matt Rhule now, it sure feels like the program has a much more solid foundation. Feels like he's rooting out a lot of that dysfunction that maybe went back over multiple coaching staffs. Do you think it's okay for us sensitive Husker fans to finally believe that that is the case, that we're getting back on track?
Yeah, I think so. You know, when you guys gave me this prompt, I wanted to come with three reasons why I think it's okay to believe in the optimism or believe in the hype this time around. We've talked about one of them, and that was my number two, and that was defense. My number one was that Scott Frost is not the head coach. Now, again, some of that certainly is the hindsight. Right, like 2019, the cracks started showing.
Son of a bitch,
the cracks. And you guys talked about it a lot in that episode with Evan, so I don't want to, you know, repeat anything that was already said there. But like the Colorado game that year, like whew, there are some massive cracks that start showing. The Minnesota game is the Colorado one was when I first started thinking. Maybe I was wrong. The Minnesota game was one where I was like, oh, this is just disgusting. And the Iowa game and the tire fire that was the end of that, mismanagement of time and down and distance and all that stuff is really when I started saying, I don't think that he is going to be the guy. So all of that to then look forward. Like Matt Rhule is not perfect, right? Like last year, I'm kind of interested to see when they get in close game situations this year, just because last year's Maryland to Wisconsin late game failures where, and I said this a lot on my radio show, like the Maryland screw ups, it felt like it was a literal response to the Wisconsin screw ups. Like we did it that way. Let's do it a different way this time. So I'm genuinely curious. I don't think I'm concerned just yet. I'm going to give the guy grace, but you said culture there, Jeff. I think that is real. And I know that word has become such like, it's like a pejorative now, right? Like yeah, culture, right. culture. But look, I think that the results speak for themselves in terms of we are in an era of it's 2024 transfer portal. If you don't want to be there, you can leave. The number of players that left and the number of players that left that people are like, oh no. I mean, what is that? Like one or two guys?
Yeah,
I mean,
maybe.
It is as small of a list as I think you can find for a program coming off of a 5-7 season. So, okay, I think that's very real. You bring back some players that could have exhausted their eligibility because of COVID or whatever, and they decided to come back. I think that stuff is real. So I would start with that. Like, I think that there is I think Mike Schaefer said it recently on one of our shows on The Zone, that like guys want to be there for the first season that finally breaks through. I think that stuff is very real. And so like I think he's building a really good program. I think that they are going to be a tough ass football team this year. I think they were last year. It stunned me how, whether it was physicality, just how they got punched so many times. And I know that they ended up not going to a bowl game and they wilted in some situations, but to continue to, like, they got punched in the mouth in game one. Game two is, you know, turns into a disaster, and the quarterback is suddenly like, he has the yips, and it's like, oh my gosh, what is this going to mean? They get boat raced by Michigan, and then they have a Sunday practice, and they play on Friday, and they go on that 3-game winning streak. So, like, I'm definitely a believer in all of that. I like all of the things that he has put into place. I like that they brought in, you know, a quarterback's coach. I think that is going to be good. Satterfield was originally not going to coach a quarterbacks last year, but Jake Peets didn't take the job, right? He stayed in the NFL. And so Satterfield has to coach the quarterbacks. I'm certainly not I don't think I'm of myself as a Satterfield defender. I had a lot of questions about his hiring. But I really like the way that the program is being built at this moment in time. And I think that the athleticism piece and going after traits, like I really dig that. I think it's different than anything we've seen around here in quite some time. And so I'm a big fan of that.
Well, I think we'll get into the $1.4 million man before this is all said and done. Let's talk about Dylan Raiola for a minute. I mean, I think we're pretty realistic here at the Common Fan podcast. I mean, we're only guaranteeing two Heisman trophies for sure, you know, with a chance at a third Heisman probably, and maybe a fourth even.
Maybe, yeah. Unless he goes pro, right? Yeah.
Yeah, right, exactly. Unless he doesn't stay for 4 years.
Yeah.
But in all honesty, I mean, he's a true freshman. It's fair to expect some growing pains. And obviously there's a lot to be excited about. I think we're all really excited just to see like what this guy can do, what he can do in year one. I think a reason for optimism for me of 2024 versus 2019 is that he will not be asked to do as much as Adrian Martinez. I mean, if all goes well, he shouldn't be asked to do as much as Adrian Martinez was. And I think the sort of like, so to support that, to go along with this sort of line of thinking, I'm curious if you think the Huskers can establish the kind of run game that they want to establish in 2024. Because you think about whether it was all the years Adrian was there, or even last year. Like last year, I think we were what, second or third in the Big Ten in rushing?
Second.
A lot of that was the QB run game. Still, we have had a hard time establishing a traditional run game where the quarterback hands the ball to a running back or somebody other than himself, and we like can block people and run the ball. And I think if we can do that this year, then you have a team, an offense that, you know, the defense has to respect the run game, and that will open up opportunities for Dylan Raiola in the passing game. It will take pressure off of the young Raiola. Again, we're assuming he's QB one. I think that's probably all that's safe to assume. Mm-hmm. So I'm curious about your thoughts on that. Like, you know, we got a veteran offensive line coming back. I don't know that I would call it a proven offensive line in some ways. Yeah. It's funny because I feel like this offseason people have said, well, the offensive line was improved last year. I don't remember people saying that during the season in 2023, but I feel like we've been saying it in the offseason. So kind of curious about that. Like, can we establish an offensive system where, yes, we allow Dylan Raiola to shine, but we don't put everything on him to be the guy? I think that's part of where the Huskers failed. Adrian Martinez was trying to make him do so much because we weren't properly utilizing the weapons around him, or maybe we didn't have enough weapons around him.
And I, you know, that's where I wanted to go, because the third thing that I wrote down was wide receivers. You know, that year, that 2019 team, so JD Spielman was back. You know, I don't remember if you guys got into this whole lot with Evan, but he was not someone that staff liked. They did not like JD going back to when they first arrived for a variety of reasons. And there was some stuff that happened around the Minnesota game that year. I know that the like Hoodie Gate was an entire weird situation, but JD, I know, was at the center of some, I've never gotten the full story on what was going on there. Wandale Robinson was a true freshman. Kind of, I know I was on that team. Right. And he was fine. I don't think that he was maybe what we were expecting him to be. His Cal numbers, I don't think it exactly translated to Lincoln. Who was it? Probably Austin Allen, like it always was at tight end. You know, like I look at the weapons this year, and I've been pretty bullish on the wide receivers throughout much of the offseason. You want to talk about something that I'm drinking the Kool-Aid on right now? It's this group. I am a huge fan of Jamal Banks. I think that guy is going to, and my dog is named Banks too, so I'm a bit of a homer here. But I think Banks has a chance to be close to 1,000 yards. From all reports, Nayor is showing up in terms of like he'll maybe Wyoming type production versus what happened at Texas, and you know, he was injured there. So you got that. You got the young guys, you know, and we saw, you know, a few of them play last year. Obviously, Jalen Lloyd and Malachi Coleman playing as well. And so like you got them, then you got the true freshman coming in. You know, if Adoni was ever going to have a great breakout year, this would be the year, right? That was going to happen for him. And dude, the Carter Nelson stuff has been like, you want to talk about something that's come out of nowhere for me and is very intriguing. Carter Nelson playing wide receiver and being able to use some of that athleticism is, you know, a matchup nightmare is essentially what we're talking about. Don't force him out there to play tight end and have a whole lot of extra responsibilities. Get him the ball in space. Let him, you know, burn by a linebacker or something like that. So I'm very much in on pass catchers. The running back room, I'm not in on whatsoever. That said, so I've done an exercise. Emmett Johnson, for people who listen to my radio show or the ID Club, I end up like probably once every 3-4 weeks, I just go and look at his game by game logs, because last year at the end of the season, he was fine. He was good enough. He basically averaged 60 yards a game in the last six games. If the starting running back for Nebraska could average 60 yards a game, that's 720. Is that Amir Abdullah a decade ago? No. Is it Amon Green, Lawrence Phillips? No. And no, it's not Roy Helu. It's not Rex Burkhead. But 720 yards would be the best. Well, I guess Anthony Grant had close to 1,000, but a lot of that was early. Be the best, basically, running back season since Divine Azigbo in 2018. They did not have that in 2019 for a variety of reasons, right? The Mo Washington stuff, that derailed a lot of stuff in the offseason and into the season. We had to move Wandale over to running back, and he weighed, 160 pounds? So this year, I'm concerned that the team, the running game, is going to have to rely on a bunch of guys who have been injured, and then there is him, and then there's an Oregon transfer in Dowdell that, I don't know. We'll see. I went from optimistic to not optimistic to now I'm kind of optimistic, I guess. I'm a bit of a hold there. So there's a lot of questions with that group. And I guess we'll see what happens with the offensive line with the Prochaska injury. But I am buying the receivers. I'm certainly buying Raiola. Not so much the running backs. But can they throw to set up the run? I definitely think that that's possible. I definitely think it's possible.
Yeah. Well, even especially with the size of the receivers right now on the roster and on the depth chart on the 2-deep versus 2019, right? Like
bigger.
You've got, the poor man's itty bitty committee back in 2019. And now we've got some actual grown men in the, for the two transfers, Banks and Nair. And then you throw in Jalen Lloyd, who's just an absolute burner.
Yep.
And Malachi Coleman and this Barney kid, it's at least seems like on paper, it's a little bit more powerful, let's say, on the outside with weapons. But I'm totally with you on the running backs. It's kind of a show me thing.
Can I just, the show me thing, that's fair, Matty O. I want to put a stake in the ground. I think Emmett Johnson is a Big Ten back. I think he can be a three down back in the Big Ten. I'm really excited to see what he can do this year. I think he can run for 1,000 yards. I'm really bullish on Emmett Johnson. I should also say I'm not a coach. I'm not an X's and O's guy. I have no idea what I'm talking about, but I'm just really high on Emmett Johnson, and I'm super optimistic about him. And so I agree with the overall concern of the running back room, because a couple of those guys have been there since what feels like about 98, and just failed to break through, it seems like. And so I totally get having some reservations there, but if Emmett Johnson can stay healthy, it appears based on the spring game and what we know of fall camp early, he's your RB1 already, is how they're thinking about him. I'd love to be right. Maybe it's just I want to be right on this, but I think he can bust out and be a big-time Big Ten back. We'll see.
I was pleasantly surprised by him last year. One of the – John and I always do keys to the game at the end of every Friday show, and one of the ones that I always had was just get him to 20 carries. Get him to 20 carries. And he was not perfect, but the thing that I really liked about him was he was insanely consistent, except for the last game. He had 11 carries for 27 yards versus Iowa. But it was always, I'm looking at his yards per carry average, 6.1, 5.8, 4.4, 4.9, 3.8, and 2.5. So it did go down towards the end of the year. But as long, and this is maybe a negative too, but as long the whole season was 29, it was so he was always he can get you a first down and then some. But for the most part, the guy's going to get you 4 or 5 yards. And so I really like that about him. He is definitely not a perfect back. But I don't think that any of those guys are. And again, to rely on Ramir Johnson, dude, how long has he been in the program? It's been, since pre-COVID, it feels like.
I think it was pre-COVID.
Okay, so it literally was pre-COVID. So you got that situation going on. You have some other guys that are coming back from injuries. Again, you have a transfer in Dowdell. What can that group be? Maybe I'm just going to be wrong. I would love to be wrong on that group, because it really is a bunch of guys who have fought through, missing seasons, missing large chunks of their careers. Michael Bruns, we had him on our show. He joins us on Tuesdays, and he wrote a story recently about 9 players that they were watching coming off of that open practice. And Gabe Irvin was the first guy that he mentioned. And it's I think that's the first time one of us has said his name, right? We barely even mentioned him when we talk about the running back room. And you can make an argument that, of everyone who has played, his ceiling was perhaps the highest. I guess I'd probably go with Ramir, just because I remember his best version that I know for sure. Ramir versus Michigan in 2021 was pretty damn good. But I thought that he has played well also.
I've heard the word optimism and optimistic, dear Lord, so many times already in this podcast. And I don't want to be the Debbie Downer, and these guys will harp on me, because if you've listened to any previous episodes, Josh, you'll know I was raised in a Notre Dame household.
I was going to say, you're the Notre Dame guy, right?
Yeah, so I have split alliances here. So I try and keep these two Yahoos grounded in reality every once in a while, and don't let them get too far off track.
Yeah, good luck.
Yeah, you're our barometer for reality, Jeff.
Yeah.
I appreciate that, because that was my role within the Husker fan base back in 2021 and 2022. So handshake meme.
Yeah, I got you right here. I don't want to be the proverbial turd in the punch bowl, or the poop in the ice cream, or the dookie in the diarrhea.
We get
I got a lot of poop references.
What's a dookie in the diarrhea? You're all those things, Jeff. You're all those things.
If we had any concern or anything that you could think of, it sounds like maybe running backs, but anything else that you could pinpoint that might be a concern about this team coming up, I'd be all ears, because it sounds like we've covered all the positives. Is there anything that we should be nervous about?
Yeah, like, look, I think Dylan's going to be good. I think he's going to be really good. But he will also be a true freshman, and I'm sure that there's, you know, a horrible, horrible back-breaking turnover that, you know, we are waiting to talk about on our podcasts and radio shows, right? I would start there, though. That's honestly not at the top of my list. I think that the thing that I think about the most is playmakers, and I think about playmakers on both sides of the ball. Like, you know, it is very difficult to put together a 12 play 80 yard drive, just because that requires a lot of consistency, right? 12 plays, can't really have a whole lot of penalties. I mean, this program, when they get a penalty on a drive, it everything goes to shit. So can you get through a 12 play 80 yard drive? Well, how do you make up for that? You have a 50 yard play. You have an 80 yard play. Do they have those types of guys? As big, you know, I'm a big fan, as I talked about, of the receiver room. And I think that there is big play potential. I stumbled upon a video recently. It was like the 10 best plays of Nebraska in 2023. And oddly enough, Jalen Lloyd showed up three times. And I didn't realize this until then. I was like, oh, what were the numbers for the rest of the year? That was like half of his production. He had six catches. It's like, wow, we have built this guy up into something different, myself included. So like, do they have playmakers? And, you know, we began the entire pod talking about the defensive side of the ball. And I think about that. I think the defensive line is going to be very good. All the freshmen that played last year completely caught me off guard. I did not see that coming. So I think that they're going to be good. Are we sure that the back part of the defense is going to be good, though? Can they make plays? Can they get stops? Can they get off the field on third down? And like, where does natural regression come from? I'm not someone who is like, oh no, the 3-3-5, the Big Ten's going to have a field day with this defense. They struggled a lot, but there is now more film. That said, just to argue with myself for 5 seconds, like, Tony White's defense got better every year at Syracuse, so like, he obviously knows what he's doing as well. So I guess, long answer, freshman quarterback certainly would be a thing I'd be concerned about. Lack of playmakers, and look, like, they were bad in one score games. You know, I'm preaching the choir, right? I don't need to get into it. One thing that I would add on to that, though, is like, you know how you don't lose one score games? You win by two scores. You know, it's like, it's such an obvious thing, but like, the best example that I love using is last year in that Illinois game. How many times did they turn the ball over in the fourth quarter? Was it three or was it four? You know why the thing never fell apart, in my opinion? They were always up by 13. Every turnover, Illinois would get the ball, sometimes in Nebraska territory, sometimes in their own, and they always trailed by 13. Meanwhile, when they turn the ball over against Maryland, when they turn the ball over against Wisconsin, it's either a tie game or they're only up by a field goal. And so I think that that's massive. And so, like, what happens with this, when this team, if that Colorado game comes down to the fourth quarter, like, that stadium, as raucous as it's going to be at 6:38 when it kicks off, if it's tied or if Nebraska is up by a field goal and Colorado has the ball with 8 minutes to go, that place is going to be loud, but it's going to be that, like, awkward loud. Like, let's make noise, because please, God, can you just hold on?
Yeah, it's going to be the sick feeling in the stomach.
Oh, yeah. So, like, can they close one of those out? Like, I am definitely a believer in that they need to do that at some point, but not UTEP. Like, it can't be UTEP. They need to do it against Colorado, or they need to do it against Rutgers or Indiana. Like, I don't even care if it's a Big Ten team, but certainly not UTEP. Colorado would do wonders for that. But also, again, when if they just go in and they kick the crap out of UTEP and they win by four touchdowns, and it's just like, everyone can breathe, because even the two non-con wins last year were like, those were wild rides for moments at the time.
Too wild. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So I know I was a million different places, but those are the first few things that come to mind.
Love it.
Yeah. Well, I mean, we've talked about personnel a lot and I guess the concerns there. But I think we probably have to bring up the $1.4 million man, offensive coordinator Marcus Satterfield. We were pretty tough on him last fall. But I think we've collectively tried to give him a little grace, maybe give him a little chance here and see what happens here with this season. But Josh, can we really trust Marcus Satterfield?
It's an excellent question, right? Because I was like you guys, maybe preseason. I did not like the hire. His numbers at South Carolina left a lot to be desired. And I am a big time believer in, like, if the fan base that a coach leaves to go somewhere else is like, thank God, I get a little wary about it. Yep. You know, so what happened with Syracuse fans when Tony White left? It was like, are you serious?
Yeah, you guys did. Screwed.
Welcome. Enjoy Tony White. South Carolina fans were like, peace out. So I was with you. I will say though, like, and you can blame him for Jeff Sims if you want, certainly for bringing him into the program. Like, I will hear you out on that. That said, there was no way in hell that they thought Jeff Sims was going to turn in that type of performance. You know, like, you know, the Nebraska media, and I'm not here to cape for anybody, but, you know, there's been this weird, like, you guys hid that from us. And it's like, bro, if Jeff Sims was turning the ball over in practice at that rate, like, everybody would have known. It's one thing to be, like, turnover prone, right? And then it's another to not be able to catch snaps. And then the guy who started, what, 5 or 6 games after that, he was playing tight end in the first game of the season. So, right. Like, nobody saw that coming. They had to run the option. That was not an option. Coaching staff, they're borrowing old Husker coaches to come in and teach them so they can teach the players. So, like, I think giving Satterfield grace for last year, I think it's okay. Even if you want to get granular then and be like, but why did you do this or why did you do that? Like, I feel like all that stuff is fair game. This is a fascinating season for him, though, and I don't feel like the excuses are going to be there, barring some catastrophic injuries that, you know, we'd rather not talk about on this podcast. But I like again that they have Glenn Thomas. I was listening to Bet the Board with Todd Furman and Payne Insider recently. It's a gambling podcast. They did a Big Ten preview. Really good stuff. It was like 3 hours long. The Nebraska chunk, I highly recommend listening if you don't want to do all 3 hours, right? And they talked about the offense and some of the things that they're hearing behind the scenes and how it's going to play with pace, how it's going to play with tempo. And they think that Glenn Thomas's fingerprints are going to be all over the place. And so I am at the very, like they said, you know, we're going to go into the season and we're going to wipe the slate blank for Satterfield. Cause I think they agree with basically all four of us. They're not Satterfield guys either. They're going to give him a chance. They're going to give him one more chance. That's how I'm approaching this year too. So I am cautiously optimistic, but look, the final thing I would say about this is, like, Andy Reid for the longest time was viewed as like this idiot with clock management, and now no one talks about it with him anymore. Did Andy Reid get better, or did he just get the best quarterback of all time? Like, this is not to say that Dylan Raiola is the best quarterback of all time, but like, if he is the prince who is promised, like, it's gonna change the way we view everything because everything is better around him.
Yeah. TJ, that was a Game of Thrones reference there, just so you know.
Thank you, Jeff. I appreciate that. Next, you can explain to me all your video game references. Now, I'm glad you brought up, you know, last season and, you know, former Nebraska coaches coming in and teaching the option, because we're pretty sure that the powers that be were listening to the Common Fan podcast when Matty O said, I'd love to see that old school option pass. And then the next thing you know, Belly G option pass came to fruition on the field. And so, look, we're happy to help. We don't have pride of authorship. We're not here to take credit, but we're pretty sure that came from the Common Fan podcast. Might have been T.O. listening, might have been Matt Rule listening. No one will ever probably know.
I don't know.
Hard to say, but we were happy to be part of the solution to the extent that there was one last fall on offense.
Yes.
Real quick, Josh. How concerned should we be about the depth in the quarterback room? Everybody wants to see Dylan Raiola. Everybody's excited about Dylan Raiola. Fact is, he's never taken a Division I snap. Three out of the four quarterbacks in that room have never taken a Division I snap. Heinrich Harburg is the only one who has. We are huge fans of Heinrich Harburg, a.k.a. William Wallace, on this program. We believe that he will have a role this fall. Hopefully that's combination, like on the field for certain packages, using his athleticism, either at the quarterback spot or somewhere else, slash mentoring the younger players. But if he's thrust into duty Jalen Gramstad is, or something else, like how concerned should we be about the depth in the quarterback room?
I feel like I am in two separate boats with this. Like, on one hand, I understand any concern because, like, if he goes down, the season probably goes down with him, right? Like, so I'm not gonna pretend like I think that the quarterback room is that deep. I definitely found myself getting frustrated though this offseason when it's like they didn't do more, and it's like, I mean, that's like, what if you're a player who wants to start, why are you coming to Nebraska with Dylan Raiola already in the fold, right? Like, that's why the situation happened the way it did back in December with McCord not joining the party as well, because I think that he was worried that he wasn't going to be the starter, and probably rightfully so. I think, you know, it's interesting that they do have starting experience, but it's going to be the backup. So I view that as a positive. Like, after the first game, they'll have starting experience as a starter and as a backup. But, like, I don't think that could be underestimated. There are some people around the program that really do believe that Heinrich Harburg is a whole lot better, or at the very least improved, and would be better than he was a season ago. And so you got that going for you. I think Kalen, I've always viewed him as like a 2-3 years down the road kind of guy. So like, I definitely think that they would like to not have to play him. And then, I think Gramstad, for the time being, I think it's a cute story, and I don't mean that as a negative. It doesn't have to be negative. It's like, it's cool. Like, the guy grew up in Iowa and hated Iowa, like, cool. Awesome. Like, he's at Nebraska.
Sounds great.
Yeah, exactly. Like, oh, he's my kind of guy. Yeah. Come on the podcast. So like, I think that stuff is cool, but I don't, if he has to start, I would just have a whole lot of questions. And so all that to say, like, if he stays healthy, it's so funny. If we get to Iowa and we're talking and it's like, oh man, he never got hurt. No one cares about the quarterback depth. Now, I know that could be a silly thing to say, because last year, what did they start? Three guys over the course of 12 games, which is just a wild statistic. In some seasons recently, they started upwards of four guys, I think, or at least played four. So, it is what it is. I don't think it doesn't have to be the biggest negative. I think the thing I'm most curious about is Harburg. Like, what is his place on the offense? If Dylan, what if it's November and Dylan is not left unless Nebraska's up by five scores? Like, where is Heinrich Harburg's place? Again, he began last season not on the bench, not, buried on the quarterback depth chart. He began the season playing tight end, and like, he caught a pass. Like, he wasn't just some random guy out there. They obviously think the world of his athleticism. So, on one hand, I wonder how they want to use him. On the other, what if he got hurt playing tight end? Like, so I don't think he's going to be a tight end this year. I don't think that's going to happen. But like, the goal line type stuff, or certainly a trick play, like, you bring him in and you do a, an end around and he throws the ball. Like, I feel like all of that should be fair game. It's just within reason, right? Like, if he gets hurt, it does make everyone even more nervous about the quarterback situation, which would be fascinating, because it's like, you still have the starter, but the backup's hurt and everyone's freaking out.
Yeah. Well, Josh, you've been great. I think we've got maybe a couple more questions for you. TJ kind of brought this up earlier, and it's kind of new territory to me for Husker fans, but we just kind of still have this, we're hearing everything's going to be great. When we want to believe it, and I'm even guilty of, hey, we're going to win 8 or 9 games, I think. But there's still that lingering feeling of, okay, why will it be different this time? Why should we trust it will be better this time? So, Josh, we believe it will be better. Why do we believe it will be better? I can get that.
Why will this season be better?
Why will it be better than the last however many years when we were, had off season? We won every off season, and then we get to August or September, and it's fallen apart. It seems like so quickly over the last 6, 7, 8 years. Why will it be better?
I'll give you two things. The first one is, and we've mentioned him tonight, but we really have not dive too deep into Dylan Raiola. Like, I think that they have a dude, you know, and I know some people are like kind of still even nervous about even saying that out loud because how many times have they been let down by a quarterback or a coach? Like, I think Nebraska has that guy. I think they have a guy at quarterback for the first time in a long, long time. That goes a long way. This is a sport driven by quarterbacks. You know, it is the most important position in all of sports, and Nebraska is going to have that guy. I think that he has done all the right things in terms of how he's handled things off the field. You know, he's, as of the time of this recording, at the very least, he has still not been named a starter officially. Everything he does, though, everything the program does around him, everything his teammates say, he is the starter. It's just that he hasn't been named it. I think that that goes a long way. You know, his dad played in the NFL. He comes in as the five-star, looks like Patrick Mahomes. Like, you know, I have to imagine that there are guys in the locker room that were like, all right, cool. You know, like, I remember when I was 18, too. You know, it's like, I think he's proven himself, and he certainly has the skill set. So I would begin there. I think that that can be, as I mentioned earlier, Patrick Mahomes makes it so we don't talk about Andy Reid's clock management anymore. That's a pretty big deal, I think. I think that he can be really, really good. I think he can be really special. The other thing is, I do believe that Matt Rhule has done things in, and I want to say the right way, because again, that has this like Nebraskaification of like, you have to do things in a Nebraska way. I just think the guy gets it. You know, I think he has a plan. A lot of people last year, as they started 0-2, are like, everything's ruined. This sucks. He's not the guy. Like, it wasn't bothering him. He was confused. Like, why are you guys freaking out? It's okay. It's September. You know, like, that was his reaction. And I know that we don't do that, right? We have to freak out. They're 0-2. The guy, I think, is unbothered by what this place is. And that goes a long way. Frank Solich had been in the machine for years as an assistant. I don't think he realized what he was getting himself into. Callahan, he certainly didn't. Bo was a DC. He didn't get what he was getting himself into. Riley, that was such a weird situation. And Frost, again, like, if anyone was going to understand it, it was going to be the starting quarterback of a national championship team. I don't think he got it. Matt Rhule gets it. And what does that mean in wins and losses? It's not something that I can directly correlate to, right? If a quarterback throws 30 touchdowns in a season, I have a pretty good idea what that's going to mean on the field. I don't know what a coach getting it means, because I haven't really seen it since Osborne. He gets it, though. I don't think that this place intimidates him, and I think that they have done everything this offseason, you know, for the sole purpose of having a big year. Like, he has talked publicly over the last month and a half, first to Joel Klatt, then at Big Ten Media Days. The guy believes in this program this year. I'd been hearing that months ago, that like behind the scenes, he really believes in this place, in terms of 2024, and thus probably beyond, I would guess. But I know he thinks that they can have a good season. I know that they like the schedule. I know that they like the players. And I really think that Dylan Raiola has given everybody a pep in the step inside of a North Stadium anymore. I got to change what I say, inside of the new, whatever, Osborne Complex, whatever it's called now.
That's a good, he gets it. I 100% agree with you. Like, he says all the right things. He's always prepared when he's in front of a camera. He just knows what to say, says the right things, does the right things. We've covered a lot in this episode, so I promise we'll just knock it out with one last question here. Pretty easy. I'll steal a phrase from my co-host Tyler J. Burkle just to put a bow on this episode, so to speak. What's your record prediction for this year?
Damn it. I have not had to say this yet. So I have been going back and forth. Yes, you guys are going to get me first.
The common fans are like Woodward and Bernstein. We're going to put you on the spot. We're going to get to the bottom of the story.
This is unreal. We're in a parking garage right now trading notes. I've been a 7-5 guy.
Jeff is deep throat. Sorry, go ahead.
I was wondering who's going to make that reference first. I've been a 7-5 guy since last season ended. And I have found myself drifting over into the 8-4 group. Yes. I feel like a crazy person, man, because, like, you know, it's quite the jump. It's 3 wins. But I guess the thing that I keep thinking about is last year, and ifs and buts and candied nuts, right? Like, you know, you can't change every loss to a win, but good Lord, did they just leave some dubs out there? The Minnesota game, and the Maryland game. Like, I won't even get into Wisconsin and Iowa. Minnesota, Maryland. Those two are the ones that should have turned around. Like, that gets you to 7. I mean, like, 2 plays gets you to 7 wins. So I think that they can, okay, can they get to 7? Absolutely. And it's like, if they could have done that last year, what happens if the offense, again, doesn't turn the ball over 31 times? They turned it over 31 times in 12 games. That is ridiculous. That's almost three times. It's almost three times a game. I would love to go back and rewatch games just to prepare myself for the season, but I don't want to rewatch last season. It was horrible. So I have found myself drifting towards 8-4. So I guess you guys, yes, officially, I'm an 8-4 man. You know, welcome me into the club.
Well, right. Yes.
All right. Yeah. I think I'm up to 11-1, but 8-4 is fine.
8-4 will be okay. Too.
I just saw, I think it was MGM or somebody put out new odds updates for making the CFP.
Uh-oh.
And Nebraska went from plus 1800 to plus 900.
Oh my god.
So take the boys in the desert know something, boys.
You want to talk about something that, like, you know, because of this new era of the 12 team playoff, like, you know, it's going to be so fascinating, right? Like, what does this mean? How cool will this be? When this program is entering November and they're in the mix for the first time, like, I don't know what's going to happen. The last time they were good again was 2016. A lot of people around here were dubious. The last time that people really believed in the program collectively was like 2010, when everyone was rowing the boat in the same direction. Podcasts were not a thing in 2010. Twitter was barely a thing in 2010. Patreon, subscribe today, patreon.com/IDClub. It was barely a thing. Like, all that stuff, you guys weren't doing a pod. Like, no one was doing stuff like they do now. The collective freak out, if it was like, oh my gosh, Nebraska is 13th in the CFP rankings on November 12th. Not only are we going to watch their game, but like, oh, who's the 10 seed? It's Ole Miss. We got to root for Georgia this weekend. Like, oh my gosh, that sounds like heaven. It sounds glorious.
It sounds glorious. I'm a little concerned I won't be able to speak full sentences and normal. Like, if that happens, I'll be so excited and nervous. I'm not sure we'll be able to keep the podcast going.
Yeah. But isn't that, that's like, as just a college football fan in general, as most of us are, that's one of the best things when Nebraska's in the mix and is relevant.
Yes.
But now, like, lately it's been like, oh, Nebraska lost. I don't really care about any of these other games.
Correct. Yeah.
My favorite thing is like, hey, we took care of business. We won. Now let's see if Ohio State
watch the rest of the games.
You can watch the Notre Dame game, Matt. You can watch. I'll watch one.
Jeff, that's
you
not
come
gonna
over
happen,
to our house anytime, man. Yeah,
that's not going to happen. It's probably on like NBC or Peacock.
Yeah.
And you know what? I don't know if I'm going to keep my subscription to the cop,
Jeff,
because I just don't know if I want to hang on.
You and Satan with your empty promises, Jeff. No, Matt, you're spot on. Like, college football is like such a glorious, like, uniquely American treasure. And it is so much more enjoyable when Nebraska is in the mix. We don't even have to be in the national championship mix. It's just enjoyable when, like, we're in the top 25 mix, and it's like, okay, let's hope these teams ahead of us lose since we won already, and we can jump up, you know, two places in the top 25. Like, it's so much more fun when Nebraska's relevant. It's not just getting back to a bowl game. In my opinion, it's like the steps to get back to greatness are like bowl game number one, relevance number two, like being in the conversation. That doesn't even mean getting to the playoff. It just means being relevant and being a top somewhere in like 15 to 25 team every year, and just being part of that conversation. And like, that's what's so infuriating. That's part of the reason why we did the Reckoning series, is it never needed to get so bad as it did. Like, we never needed to fall as far as we did. It's not that much to ask to get back to relevance, because then when you're relevant, you're one step away from that playoff.
Yeah, Jeff, I'll say this to you, Jeff, because you're a Notre Dame guy. Like, I am definitely one of those that believes that the sport's more fun when Notre Dame's good. You know, like, cool. I like it when they're good.
Okay, also, Josh, we're going to wrap up here.
And you know what? Part of it is I don't hate Notre Dame, but I will say it's funny then when they're good and lose. So it's like, it's good for all parties involved. Like, you know, so, I think that stuff is really special. And I know that the generation, I'm a little younger than you guys, I think, but we're all kind of in the same age range. I know that people that watch the sport feel that way about Nebraska, because their nostalgia kicks in big time.
And if just to piggyback off of that, to have a little bit more optimism, I think, was it 2018? I think is when was Rule at Temple then. And he gave Notre Dame a run, like, on
I think it was early. I think it was 2015. A little earlier than that.
It was his last year there before he went to Baylor.
Okay. Yeah.
They had College Game Day. College Game Day was at Temple.
In Philly, right? Yeah. At the Link. Yep. Yeah,
I mean, you know, it's exciting to think about. It doesn't take much to give Notre Dame a run, Jeff.
Just trying to be positive.
There you go.
Wrap it up, Teej. Just wrap it up.
I'm sorry. I just can't help. You know, it's like in Rudy. As long as my brother talks this crazy Notre Dame shit, he deserves everything that comes his way. we love you, Frank and Rudy. All right. Josh Peterson, ladies and gentlemen, what a fun discussion. Thanks so much for joining the Common Fans.
Yeah, thanks, Josh. Yeah,
thank Josh, you, any Josh. Final thoughts? Or
no, man, I'm genuinely excited. I know that it has taken some people back in my life. TJ, you joined Jack and I, especially on the I-80 Club. And Jack, as our relationship has gotten close in recent years, he has only known me as the guy who is pessimistic, though I would say realistic, about Nebraska football when I when I'm predicting records in the offseason and stuff. So he is like very like, what do I do with positive Josh? And I would say, you just join me because I've been right about this program since the COVID year. So hop on board. They're going to be good. And it's in all seriousness, I think that it they're going to be good and it's going to make for a wild ride because whether it's your podcast, the many other podcasts around here, radio shows, like there is this whole generation of media and then certainly fans that either barely remember or don't remember what it's like. And yeah. I think that, you know, collectively, all of us want it to happen. That's the sneaky. Everyone thinks the media wants Nebraska to lose. No, we want them to be good. It would be so much more fun. It's been depressing as hell around here. What a good season for the first time in a while. So I think it's going to be a whole lot of fun. I really cannot wait for the season to kick off.
All right. And where can common fans find the I-80 podcast and join the community?
Yeah. Patreon.com/I-80 Club. We have a couple of subscription tiers. If you just are in it for the content, if you want to watch our shows live on YouTube on Wednesday nights, on Saturday mornings, you can join for $5 a month if you want access to that stuff. And you get pods with that too. You get those pods immediately. If you want access to that, plus our Discord community, which is really, really good. Shaq wanted to start something without the toxicity of Twitter. It's kind of what he was going for when we started. I just wanted to do pods with Shaq. The community we have built is incredibly special. So that tier is $8 a month. It is a whole lot of fun. We're going to be doing Saturday night shows this year. And we're hoping to do last year, Mike Schaefer and I think we did like 6 or 7 NFL pods on Sundays. We are trying to up that number and do close to 20 this year, live on Sunday nights as well. So, we'd love to have you. Patreon.com/ID Club. And then, radio show 2 to 6, 1620 The Zone, the usual, you know, download the pod, unsportsmanlike conduct, yada, yada, yada.
Do you get like a nice ribbon for the I-80 Club? Maybe a ribbon you can wear to church or something.
Oh, that's a great idea. We do have hats coffee mugs.
Coffee mug. That's nice. Okay.
Yeah, good. Exactly.
That awesome. Sounds great.
Something to keep in mind for our pod, TJ.
Yeah, that's right. That's exactly right.
There you go.
All right. Check out the I-80 Club. Check out Unsportsmanlike Conduct from 2 to 6 p.m. on 1620 The Zone. And check out Chasing 3 Hours if you are a runner or even if you're not a runner. I would imagine for me, I try to avoid exercise. I would imagine it's inspiring even for people who don't like to run.
So, yeah, I'd like to think so. Some of the runners that like I had a chance recently to talk to 2 Olympians. So obviously those are a whole different level. I've also talked to people who are back of the pack marathoners, including my dad. I actually got a chance to talk to my dad over the course of 2 episodes. So
nice.
I think it's really good. I think it's really fun. And I think even if you hate running or despise it, or at the very least, maybe you tolerate it, I think that you can get something from it. So yeah, Chasing 3 Hours is also available wherever you get your pods.
Love it. Nice. All right, Common Fans, check out www.commonfan.co. Subscribe to the YouTube channel. Subscribe to the free newsletter. And just check out and keep up with all the fun and frivolity of the Common Fans. Thanks again to Josh Peterson for a phenomenal conversation. We will be back at you soon, Common Fans. In the meantime, as always, GBR for life.